Hello, welcome to Subway. Can I get you anything?
Is that how it's really pronounced?
How's what's pronounced?
I'd like a tuna fish footlong with olives, please.
All right, sir, one tuna fish with olives coming up.
Why are you saying it like that?
Like what?
Tuna fish?
Because that's what you ordered?
No, I ordered tuna fish. A tuna fish sandwich.
And that's what I'm giving you. Tuna fish. Because that's what we serve here at Subway. 100% real, genuine tuna fish.
Stop it! Are you messing with me? Is this some sort of like YouTube prank channel or something? Tell me right now with a straight answer. Is that a tuna fish sandwich made with actual tuna fish?
No, it's not.
Then what is it? Also, why are there so few olives? Internet, welcome to Food Theory, the show that never passes up an opportunity to do an episode on the world's largest fast food restaurant chain. That's right, theorists. Once again, Food Theory finds itself riding the old Subway. But honestly, what else could I do? Subway has the best lawsuits to talk about. One day, they're getting sued because their footlong sandwiches aren't exactly a foot long. The next day, a Canadian news program is claiming Subway's chicken is actually half soy. The next, the Irish Supreme Court is declaring Subway's bread too sugary to be considered bread. At this point, I could probably just spin off an entire channel dedicated to Subway theory. Eat fresh. But now, theorists, it seems as though the Subway lawsuit to end all Subway lawsuits is upon us. Last month, defendants Nilima Amin and Karen Danawa, oh no, it's a Karen alert, filed a complaint about some fishy behavior going on at the local Subway. Or maybe I guess it was the opposite of fishy. I'll let you be the judge. According to their complaint, the tuna sandwiches that they'd been buying didn't actually have tuna in them. Now, this might not come as a huge surprise to anyone who's been paying attention. After all, a 2019 report by Oceana showed that over 20% of fish sold in the US is mislabeled, which is a stat in and of itself that is absolutely insane. I mean, think about that. According to this study, which was done in multiple states with hundreds of fish, 1 in 5 fish that you order is you getting the wrong fish. According to the report, if you order sea bass, the chances of you actually getting real sea bass is less than half. It is a wild report and an easy short read, so the link is down in the description if you want to have that veil ripped off your eyes. And get this, that 20% error rate actually holds true worldwide, which, it's just sad, man. Stop being skeezy business owners, people, just saying. But here's the part that really reeled me in on this story. These women are claiming that this was no accident. They're accusing Subway of intentionally serving non-tuna in order to cut their costs. And we're not just talking about non-tuna here. This wasn't just them swapping out a cheaper fish. According to the complaint, they quote, found that the ingredients were not tuna and not fish. Okay, what? Theorists, this simply boggles the mind. Because if the tuna tasting material found in Subway's tuna sandwich isn't even fish, what the heck is it? Ahem, what is this?
Tuna?
Just give me a cookie. The dietary restrictions, religious and otherwise, that would be violated if customers were eating tuna sandwiches that secretly contained non-fish meat. Think of all the allergy and health risks posed to unwitting customers. It's an ethics issue, a health issue, and absolutely a legal issue. Now, the plaintiff's complaint is light on the details. Their filing didn't explain what tests were conducted, and it offers no information as to what the so-called tuna might actually be. Only that it is, quote, made from anything but tuna. Currently, the duo is suing for $5 million. However, as the Washington Post reports, quote, attorneys for Danawa and Amin hope to get their claims certified as a class action, which could open the case up to thousands of Subway customers in California who purchased tuna sandwiches and wraps after January 21st, 2017, which, ironically enough, would include me. Now, the burden of proof is on the accusers, and they haven't presented any actual evidence as of yet, but the women claim to have lab test results to prove their case. They don't really say what those tests were, how they were conducted, and what exactly was found, but apparently they're there, maybe. Subway, as you can imagine, has flatly denied all of this. So here's what I want to know today, theorists. Is it true? Is this yet another example of Subway being exposed? Or is there something else going on here? Who's gonna win this lawsuit, friends? And most importantly of all, what is Subway's tuna actually made of? Let's dive in, theorists. Something smells fishy, and it's time to see what's up. Now, immediately off the bat, this Subway lawsuit is different from the ones that came before. This isn't an argument about the definition of footlong or the amount of sugar in bread. This is as clear-cut as it gets. They're claiming there is no fish whatsoever present in the tuna salad that Subway serves. And shortly after filing the complaint with the court, the plaintiff's attorney began reaching out to the media. Not just the local and regional outlets either. They emailed directly with the Washington Post. National outlets picked up the story in no time. I mean, who can resist a title like Subway's tuna is not fish? Like I said, who can resist it? So far, the plaintiff's attorneys seem more than a little confident. But confident as the plaintiffs might seem, Subway is even more confident. After news of the lawsuit went public, the company immediately jujitsued their potential bad PR into good PR by doubling down on the fact that they serve 100% wild-caught tuna, then promptly launching a 15% off deal on tuna products so people can decide for themselves. So Subway is hardly shying away from the lawsuit. In fact, they're leaning into it. But no amount of posturing on either side can change this simple truth. One side is clearly right and the other side is clearly wrong. Either Subway's tuna contains fish or it doesn't. So which is it? Well, theorists, this is one of those times where I actually have to side with the company Subway. You guys know me, this channel holds nothing sacred. We will not hesitate to point out sketchy business practices by the big chains. But in this case, the only thing fishy here is the lawsuit itself. You see, the whole situation is eerily familiar, kind of like history repeating itself. Just as Subway is accused of serving tuna that isn't tuna, back in 2011, Taco Bell was accused of serving beef that wasn't beef. That lawsuit, which coincidentally was also filed in late January and also in the state of California, was also announced in a very similar way. The attorneys immediately rushed to the media and claimed to have test results that no one was allowed to see from a laboratory that no one was allowed to know the name of. In this case, Taco Bell was accused of serving a meat filling that contained far less beef than the restaurant claimed it did. In response, Taco Bell immediately launched an aggressive advertising counter campaign, spending between $3 and $4 million on full-page newspaper ads in USA Today, The Wall Street Journal, The New York Times, among others. These ads, get this, began with the words, "Thank you for suing us," which, slow clap, is just a ballsy move, guys. The premise of the ad campaign was that by getting sued and making headlines, it gave Taco Bell the chance to talk about how much quality their beef actually does contain. In April of 2011, 3 months after it all began, the plaintiff voluntarily dismissed their lawsuit against Taco Bell, which, if you truly had solid lab-based evidence for your claims, you probably wouldn't do. According to Taco Bell, no money exchanged hands and no changes were made to their products, ingredients, or advertising. And it seems to me that the whole Subway situation is just the Taco Bell case all over again. I mean, consider this. In order for Subway to get away with lying about their tuna for years, we're talking about a small conspiracy with lots of dumb decisions along the way. First, someone high up would have to decide that the price of tuna, which is estimated to be about 16 cents per 6-inch sub, was so high that the only option was to lie, break the law, and thereby risk a massive lawsuit. It assumes that, for whatever reason, Subway, despite the high tuna cost, just didn't remove the sandwich from the menu. It assumes that raising the price of those sandwiches to cover those extra costs wasn't an option. And that is just the basics. It then assumes that Subway was able to develop not a non-tuna alternative, but a full-on non-fish alternative that tasted so similar to tuna that customers couldn't really tell the difference. Because remember, the claim here is that there is no fish in the sandwich. Not just no tuna, no fish. And then not only did they develop this alternate fish meat, but then they made it at a cost that remains cheaper than just buying the darn fish in the first place. Further, it assumes that Subway, after developing a non-tuna substitute, would choose not to shout this discovery from the rooftops and develop an entirely new sandwich marketed towards vegetarians, vegans, and or the 1% of the population that's allergic to finned fish. Finally, it assumes that people up and down Subway's supply chain, from distributors to factory workers to store managers to employees, including the companies listed as its tuna providers, companies that have certified Subway's tuna as dolphin safe, all of them were either in on it or oblivious to the whole thing. That's a lot of assumptions, friends. Granted, just because an explanation's complex doesn't necessarily mean it's untrue, but Occam's razor would suggest that Subway is on the right side of this one. Also known as the law of parsimony, Occam's razor is a problem-solving principle that states that the simplest explanation is usually the correct one. And here are two sides, our massive tuna fish conspiracy versus some people looking to squeeze a buck out of Subway. I mean, think about it this way. I started this episode talking about all the previous cases that Subway has been through in recent years. The sugary bread, the short footlong, the claims that were made about Subway's chicken being more filler than chicken, and now all of this about their tuna fish. When the footlong lawsuit was a thing back in 2015, Subway tried to to settle out of court to get the whole thing to go away as fast as possible. They even admitted that, despite them believing that they were in the right, the media frenzy is the thing that got them to try and pay to make it go away. The bad PR was too much for them. And maybe that's why we see Subway in the news so frequently with these catchy headlines. Subway has shown the world that they're willing to settle these types of lawsuits, earning a quick payday for the plaintiffs and the lawyers, provided that you make enough noise in the headlines. And now, there's blood in the water as everyone looks to take their own bite. Subway even addresses this very issue in their statement about the tuna fish. Quote, "Unfortunately, this lawsuit is part of a trend in which the named plaintiff's attorneys have been targeting the food industry in an effort to make a name for themselves in that space." But here's the thing that everyone tends to overlook: how these cases end. Oh, sure, they all start with these really splashy headlines, but does anyone actually know how the Subway footlongs aren't actually 12 inches long debacle ended? Because that is our key to all of this. As I just mentioned, Subway first tried to settle this thing out of court for about $500,000 to make it all go away. But then, even that decision was thrown out. The 7th U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals said nope. A 3-judge panel said that Subway didn't have to pay a cent because the whole case amounted to a racket, an attempt to try and shake down the company for easy money. Quote, "A class action that seeks only worthless benefit for the class and yields only fees for class counsel is no better than a racket and should be dismissed out of hand," end quote. So what does all of this mean for our tuna case? Well, a decade after Taco Bell's Beefgate, Subway is following their playbook to a T. Like Taco Bell, they spun the bad PR into a counter campaign offering customers 15% off tuna, and using it as a platform to explain how their high quality tuna is delivered to the restaurant. My point is, even though it seems like Subway is constantly being bombarded with these lawsuits, none of these huge eye-catching accusations tend to stick. Time and time again, Subway and these other fast food restaurants are showing themselves to be acting above board in the eyes of the judges. That is why I believe that Subway is gonna walk away from all of this tuna tumult unscathed. And if I'm wrong and Subway was feeding us some non-fish material this entire time, well, I wanna know how the heck Subway invented an allergen-free tuna alternative that costs less than real tuna, and why on earth they thought it was a good idea to keep that sort of revelation secret. But hey, that's just a theory. A Subway theory. Eat fresh. Thanks for watching, theorists, and a very special thank you to James from The Odd Ones Out, our Subway employee extraordinaire. He has a whole series of hilarious confessions of his time as a Subway employee, so click the link that you see on screen right now to check those videos out. They are great. And by the way, if you are curious about Subway's other eye-popping court cases, be sure to check out our episode on why Subway's bread isn't bread. Don't blame me, that one's on Ireland. That link is also on screen right now.